This is Radio Ecoshock with Alex Smith.
New snippets coming out of the Bahamas Islands after Hurricane Dorian are hiding an awful truth. The real death toll will be staggering. America is closing its doors to its next-door neighbors in need. And it's bigger than that. What islands in the Caribbean will have to be abandoned? It's about time to figure that out. Paul Beckwith teaches climate science at universities and on the net with more than 500 climate videos on YouTube. Paul is a regular contributor to Radio Ecoshock. Paul Beckwith, thank you for dropping by on such short notice.
Thank you for having me, Alex.
I admit, I thought your video about the Bahamian death toll and your wild solution was too much, even for this show. But, you know, within 24 hours, the mainstream media was swinging right in your direction. And so let's start with the death toll, which was obviously lowballed from day one. What were they saying about the number of fatalities when you started making your video?
Well, first of all, I mean, people don't really understand the extent of the destruction. I mean, you've got basically 185 mile per hour sustained wind, 25 foot storm surge. You know, it sits over the island for 2 days, literally. And 185 miles an hour, I mean, that's sustained. There were gusts up to 225, and buildings just can't survive that. I mean, an EF4 tornado is, I think, about 166 to 200 miles an hour, roughly. EF5 greater than 200 miles an hour. So we're talking about EF4, EF5 tornado sitting on top of you, not for a minute like it happens with the tornadoes, but for a full day. So the destruction was enormous. And they were saying a death toll of five. You know, they said at least five people have died. And what they did is they had five bodies in body bags. And then the number went to 10 and 15 and 20. And I think the latest is 50. And these numbers are just completely absurd. Like, they make no sense whatsoever, and they mislead the public as to how bad the storm really is.
Aerial shots of Abaco Island found communities just a jumble of wreckage, and yet they were only finding a dozen bodies at first. What do you think happened to some of the people there?
Well, to come up with my number, I didn't just pull it out of a hat. I said, okay, look, what's the populations of these places? So Grand Bahama is just over 51,000. I couldn't even find up-to-date numbers. That's a 2010 number. If you go on Wikipedia for Grand Bahama, Wikipedia for Abaco Island. Okay, so 51,000, you know, and it's probably close. It's probably a bit higher because the population versus on its death is probably a bit higher. There's not much immigration. Anyway, so 51,000 plus on Grand Bahama and 17,000 plus on Abaco Island, but also there were a lot of undocumented Haitians, so estimated 7,000 to 9,000 on Abaco and 10,000 to 12,000 on Grand Bahama. So what I did is I thought, okay, well, I mean, two-thirds of the island was submerged. You look at the damage, not many people left. 20,000 hot meals were served of people, survivors going on to different islands, you know, roughly, but that included support workers as well, so a bit less. You know, how many people were going to the U.S., how many people were lining up to get off on ferries and stuff to be evacuated after the storm. You know, just the lack of people. I mean, those images were horrifying. Flattened building. What can survive the conditions that were unleashed by Hurricane Dorian on these islands? So basically, I started coming up with estimates, trying to consider all of the factors, you know, top-down estimates. And, you know, I came up with a number of something like 30, 35, 40,000. So I did the video. And since I did the video, actually some relief workers on the ground commented on my YouTube channel. And one of them that seemed most legitimate was saying that, you know, of the 17,000 people on Abaco Island, maybe 2,000 left, evacuated before the storm. After the storm, they took about 3,500 people off the island, so that's 5.5. So 17 minus 5.5 is about 11,500 people that were missing, presumed dead, from Abaco Island alone. Now, Grand Bahama, you know, lots of people are on Freeport Island, so of that 51,000, this, you know, this relief worker said, estimated maybe 20% of the population perished from Grand Bahama, which would be another 10,000. So his number was about 21,500 people. I said, well, those are all the people that are documented. What about the undocumented people? And he didn't think, you know, basically on Abaco, Marsh Harbor, there were very, very few survivors. So you need to add about another, you know, 9,000 people, 7 to 9, call it 8 from Abaco, you know, undocumented Haitians, add another, you know, on Grand Bahama, there's maybe 10 to 12,000 undocumented Haitians estimated. So, you know, lots in Freeport. So and they were on lower ground and didn't have the, they had shanty type shelters and stuff. I mean, they weren't protected. They weren't in decent buildings. So, you know, so if even half of them perish, that would be about 5,000. So if you add all those numbers together, you know, 10 from Grand Bahama, 11 and a half from Abaco, and then 8 and 5 for the Haitians, that those numbers all add up to about 35 something. And this is I found out after the fact. I did the video, and then I got some information the next day, you know, and I added up the numbers and said, are my numbers told any is there any truth to my numbers? Are they? I hope I'm terribly wrong, but you know that relief worker. If you add those numbers from him, it's about 35,000 or something. It's unbelievable how mainstream media reports on death tolls after a catastrophe. You know, they find five bodies. You know, and not the wreckage, and they say the death toll is 5 or greater. Right? You can always say 5 or greater, you know. Yeah, 40,000 is greater than 5 people, right? But, I mean, the numbers are completely absurd, and given the horrendous, you know, category, you know, EF4, EF5 equivalent tornado sitting over you for 2 days, not going, passing by in a minute or 2 minutes like it normally does. I mean, the gusts were up to 225 miles an hour. Like I said, the storm surge, 2/3 of the island was submerged. So death tolls are huge. And I don't understand why, you know, anybody can sort of, with common sense, can sort of reason through what I've done. It's not rocket science and say, you know, the numbers, that official numbers are just out to lunch completely. You know, many, many people would have deemed it as just washed out to sea. The storm surge coming in, being there for a long period of time, several days, and then washing out to sea. I mean, the people missing is probably at least half. So doing body counts on the ground, you know, isn't the reality of what happened. The only way they can know for sure is to do an accurate population census of the whole country, figure out how many people went to the U.S., et cetera, add those numbers, and then compare the number of people there to the number of people on the whole Bahamas before the previous population census, estimate the number of undocumented people, add them in and get a realistic number. But there nobody wants a realistic number. But the problem is it hides the extent of the disaster, the catastrophe.
But why? You know, I mean, the Russians still claim only 30 people died from radiation at the Chernobyl nuclear accident in the 1980s. And the Japanese say only one person died from all that radiation release when 4 nuclear reactors blew up at Fukushima. I just don't get it. Why do governments have to hide the deaths? And wouldn't it be in the interests of the government of the Bahamas to say, yes, we think tens of thousands of people have passed here, and that's why we need your international aid. That's why we need international aid workers right now. But instead, it's like 5 people. Oh, well, we found 10 today. It's crazy.
I know. It's totally absurd. And the problem is, like, if Reuters comes and says 5 people or more, then that report is taken by other news agencies and goes around the world, CAN News, right? So, you know, you hear the same thing from multiple news agencies. You know, I mean, these catastrophes and people dying, you know, it's a very difficult topic. And governments are just extremely happy to hide that information, like to not let the true numbers come out. In the case of the Bahamas, 50% of their gross national product is from tourism. You know, when people hear the Bahamas got struck, they're really, you know, there's so many different islands on the Bahamas, and the two northernmost islands, Grand Bahamas and Abaco Island, those are ones that got destroyed completely by the hurricane. But there's lots of other Bahama islands, lots of other people. You know, if it was 30 to 40,000 people perished, that's over 10% of the total population of the Bahamas, and they want more and more tourists to go. They don't want tourism is going to take a big hit, of course, with these storms, but they're downplaying the number of casualties. I mean, they try to downplay the severity of the event, and it does the world no good at all, because you know, we really have to talk about how these hurricanes, we're getting more, for every degree Celsius rise in temperature, there's 25 to 30% more Category 4 and 5 hurricanes versus Category 1 and 2. The storms are moving more slowly. These hurricanes are moving more slowly, and we had unprecedented stalling of the Category 5 Dorian right over the Bahamas. It was like it was pegged there. It like got stuck there. And the conditions, of course, with those winds for such a long period of time and the storm surge, I mean, nobody can survive that. Like, I'm amazed when I see the, you know, houses that look like they're relatively intact on those islands. I mean, they must have been submerged first before the 200-mile-an-hour, 185-mile-an-hour winds came. Otherwise, they wouldn't be there, right? So they were probably submerged, and then the winds were blowing, of course, above the water, and then when the storm surge went down, the walls are still intact and so on some of these houses. I think that's probably what may have happened.
And then I had such a problem accepting your number as anything realistic, you know, up to 40,000 dead in the Bahamas. And then I realized that we've become numb to high death numbers anyway. Up to 70,000 people died in that, the European heat wave of 2003, about 60,000 in the Russian heat wave 2010. The Boxing Day tsunami 2004 killed over 200,000 people in Asia. So as climate change gets even worse with these surreal events, I suppose we'll just accept numbers like tens of thousands dead, and as long as it doesn't happen in the United States or to anybody we know, well, life goes on, doesn't it?
Yeah. I mean, there's a very famous or infamous quote. I think it's attributed to Stalin. I mean, the death of one person is a tragedy. The death of a million people is a statistic. Like I said, I mean, we really need to have a census on the population. You know, we need to count the number of people and compare them to what was done before. But since governments aren't really that interested, I mean, there's lots of comments on the video, of course, over 300 comments. And some people are saying, well, Bahamas just cares about living, the people left, the living people, you know, and like people have to move on. And it's just too hard to think about those sort of numbers of people. But I guess the big question is, what do we do? I mean, are we just going to rebuild the Bahamas, those islands, and go on as if nothing has happened? I mean, remember, let's go back 2 years ago, almost exactly 2 years ago, to Hurricane Irma, which had a direct hit on Barbuda, you know, a very small island, right? It's part of Antigua and Barbuda is the country, and Barbuda is north of Antigua, and the eye of the hurricane just, it was also 185-mile-an-hour winds, but it was moving along. You know, it wasn't moving that fast, but it was moving, and it went through the island, destroyed 95% of the infrastructure. Now, there's caves on the island. You know, it's a higher elevation. So there were very, very few fatalities. They said one baby died, and that was it, of the 1,600 people on the island. So if you believe that number. But anyway, then they got everybody off the island. It was the first time the island had been uninhabited for 300-400 years, they figured. And immediately, military went on the island, people to rebuild a huge airport, and they started changing the entire nature of the island. And the people that were evacuated off had no say, really, in what was done. You know, some of the males were allowed back on in about 6 weeks, but most of the people were, you know, they had to stay off the island. They were evacuated for about 3 months. Meanwhile, military contractors, you know, this is disaster capitalism, perfect example of it. They plowed over the parts of the forest and stuff. Oh, but there's caves on the island, so they figured people just went into the caves. You know, it was part of the culture there that you'd often sleep in these massive caves. So I think the population during the storm, they just went into the caves. It wasn't affected by storm surge too high up. And, you know, most people survived. And then they came out after the winds died down. They had forced evacuation. A lot of them just wanted to stay. You know, they didn't want to be evacuated, but they had no choice. So anyway, they were all moved off, and they were kept off the island for a long time. Meanwhile, the military and contractors and stuff, I mean, machinery went in, and they plowed down a vast part of the forest to put an airport, a brand new airport in. But there were caves, and that area was no good. So then they plowed a second area to try to put the new airport in, and the same thing, a third one. Finally, the fourth try, they got their new airport in. And there's, you know, people want to build big, huge hotels and stuff. I mean, basically, it's the culture that existed there, you know, is probably going to be lost. I mean, you know, when people were kept off the island for so long, their kids start going to schools and stuff. They were all in Antigua, and you know, a lot of people haven't moved back. So the other thing is that there were pledges of huge amounts of money for rebuilding, like for millions and millions of dollars. I think Canada even put up $3 million, and it was a total of about $10 million pledged, and they haven't received not a cent of the money that was pledged 2 years ago has actually gone to the island, right? I read some recent articles, you know, a February article in, you know, 2019 and another more recent article about the rebuilding, because this is very common when a place gets destroyed. Lots of countries pledge and then they don't produce any money.
Check out the Radio EcoShock website. We're at ecoshock.org.
This is Radio EcoShock. My guest is Canadian climate scientist Paul Beckwith. We were talking about storms of right now. And the power of this storm, Dorian, reminded me of a paper by James Hansen and Paul Harty. As part of their 121-page synthesis paper, they calculated that around 100,000 years ago, monster storms greater than we have ever seen smashed into the Caribbean. And that was in their paper, Ice Melt, Sea Level Rise, and Superstorms. And I think you did about 9 videos on that paper, didn't you?
Yes, I did. That was a few years ago.
Well, according to Hansen and Harty, the storm surge left massive rocks bigger than houses high in the hills of some islands, including the Bahamian island of Eleuthera. And they cited higher seas and violent storms as the cause. And then I recently found that a second study from the University of Bremen and the Leibniz Center said those rocks could have been tossed that high just with today's storms when sea levels were 20 to 30 feet higher during the Eemian hot period. That was around 125,000 years ago. I guess where I'm going with this, as sea levels rise and the oceans get hotter and hotter, could we see even bigger hurricanes that threaten to batter the Caribbean and the United States, forcing a retreat from the sea?
Yes, that's a big risk, of course. And it leads to the question, direct question today, should we rebuild at all? This is what humans do, right? Stuff gets destroyed and people just rebuild and rebuild and rebuild. But we have to really think differently and start getting a lot smarter about this. I mean, in previous shows, and, you know, we both talked about areas of the world that could become uninhabitable. And we've talked about places in the Middle East, for example, next to bodies of water, where if the water temperature gets to 35 Celsius, then the wet bulb temperature, you'll have 100% humidity on the coastlines with that temperature over 35, and people can't live outside for more than a day. They get heat exhaustion, heat stroke, and their body shuts down. They're outside, so they have to be confined to inside. So those areas, you know, are candidates for becoming uninhabitable. But also the Caribbean islands are in the direct firing line of these hurricanes. And, you know, with rapid sea level rise and the latest science in the last decade on how we're getting more and more Category 4s and 5s and less 1s and 2s, like I said, 35 to 40% more Category 4s and 5s than that decrease in 1s and 2s. The ocean temperature is so much warmer, and the hot water fuels these storms. Anything over 26.5 degrees Celsius amplifies the storms. The jet streams are slowing and wavier, so the steering of the storms is, you know, the storms are slowing down and even stalling. I mean, I've never seen the National Hurricane Center forecast, you know, on Dorian was stationary, storm stationary, right? And then it's moving 1 mile an hour and so on. I mean, these things are all, you know, that's the reality of today, and they're getting worse. So one thing that I really suggested quite a bit is that, like they knew the storm was coming, right? They knew Dorian was coming, and it was, you know, the Bahamas, the Northern Islands were in the bullseye, but they had no capability or capacity to get people off the island in any large numbers. I mean, maybe 1,000, 2,000 left in private boats or things like that. I don't know. So what I think would be very important to give these Caribbean islands some resilience is they need to buy and run their own cruise boats, right? Because if they own the cruise boats, they could run the cruise boats with their own people. You know, there's high unemployment on these islands, and 50% of their revenue is from tourism anyway. So they run the cruise boats, and then you can collect the huge profits from the cruise boats and use them into making your islands more resilient. But if they own their own cruise boats, and cruise boat, they can carry 5,000 people plus for a week at a time with all the food and everything. if they were just using it to transport people from one island to another, they could probably get 10 or 15,000 or more on one cruise boat. So they could have sent a couple of boats to the island and got everybody off, you know, the day before the storm struck, for example. So I think if they actually managed and owned their own cruise boats, that would be a way that would give these islands much, much greater resiliency.
When I saw you suggest the Bahamas should buy its own cruise ship for evacuations and run them for profit during better weather, my first reaction was, that's just too silly. I couldn't accept that. And then the very next night, ABC News said the government was considering buying at least one cruise ship to house evacuees. So, again, you were right on ahead of everybody else, and it may very well happen.
Yeah, there's not enough people that do logical thinking. I mean, of course, the large companies on the mainland run the industry, right? And they hire people from all around the world to staff the huge boats. And it's very, you know, it's very wealthy people that go on these long cruises. And because they rely on tourism so much in these small Caribbean islands, it should be all of the Caribbean islands should be running their industry because most of those boats go there. There's a great book called Seasteading by a guy called Joe Quirk, and I bought it sort of on a lark, thinking people should live at sea, basically, is the premise. And, you know, there's an example. There are some people that live at sea. I mean, there's a few elderly people that live on cruise boats, and they basically don't have homes, and they just go around the world wherever the cruise boat takes them. You know, get good medical care. There's a gym right there. They get to see the world. It's not boring, right? And, you know, I mean, they can afford to do it because they don't have a house. They sold their house and they, you know, put the money in, and they're, you know, they basically get good rates to live on the cruise boat, right? So great food and, you know, lots of pluses. So imagine, you know, imagine if they rebuilt these islands but didn't load them up with people, that they had boats offshore, you know, whether it be a cruise type boat or a specially designed boat offshore, and these were anchored to the islands, and you grew your food and got your fresh water and stuff on the islands. The islands were mostly for tourism, and a hurricane comes along, you just sail away and then let the hurricane pass and then come back, and with all the people that are living on these large seasteading type boats, and sea level rises, you know, no big deal for your accommodations, right? I mean, we got to start thinking differently. Like, we can't just go and do everything the way we've used to do it. And, you know, when you think about all of the advantages that these islands would have if they had the capability to move people from island to island by owning their own cruise boats and running them for tourism, but come storm season, you have, I figure, two or three cruise boats could have got the 50,000 people off the island a day before the Category 5 hit.
Okay, so we're starting to run out of time, Paul. There's like three quick things I'd sort of like to just get your take on. One is, I think we need a map of the Caribbean islands that are low enough they will become drowned countries, like Pacific Island countries of Tuvalu or Kiribati. And so far, I haven't found a map showing those low elevation places or a report on the future of the Caribbean in a new climate. Have you found that?
Nothing general on comparing elevations or topography of the region, but if you focus your research on one specific island, for example, you know, if you Google, you can find the information. Like the topographic map for Grand Bahama, for example, is right on. If you just go to Wikipedia Grand Bahama, right, there's a write up and, you know, about the place and the people, and there's a topographic map. And the same thing with, you go Wikipedia Abaco Island, right, Great Abaco, you can find the topographic map and the population numbers, you know, recent and you know, all this information. So you could go and do that. You'd have to do that for each of the different islands.
But no, it doesn't seem like anybody's drawn that together. And I think after this storm, that's something that's going to happen. I predict that within the next year, we'll be talking about a scientific paper that looks at the future of the Caribbean in terms of sea level rise and major storms. And the other thing is, where are the people going to go? I mean, the people in the South Pacific Islands, some of them have made arrangements for new land settlements in Australia or New Zealand, and they'll go when they have to. But Nobody's talking about that for the Caribbean. And I noticed that America just officially shut its doors to a lot of evacuees from the Bahamas. That's not a way to treat your next door neighbors in an emergency, but that's what's happening. So we don't really have a plan for where people can go.
I know this is a huge problem. I mean, so, you know, the Caribbean, lots of the parts of the Caribbean are at risk of becoming uninhabitable places. And also, island people are generally more resilient than, you know, lots of people that are on large countries on mainland, because they have to be more resilient, right? They're on an island. They can't access things as easily, especially on the smaller islands. So they have to really look at ways they can become more self-reliant. And, you know, again, it comes back to they need the ability to transport large numbers of people from one island to another island, especially, you know, when in hurricane season. You know, if they'd had a couple of cruise boats that hold 5,000 people for a week or 7,000 people for a week, I'm sure you could get 20,000 on one to just shuffle them to another island. So a couple of them, you could have evacuated. They could have evacuated those islands, you know, in the day before. And we knew the storm was coming very accurately. It was going to have a direct hit on these islands. And yet very few people were able to get off those islands. You know what I'm like saying? Like, people just don't grasp the enormity of what's going on.
Yep.
Whenever something like this happens, the deaths reported by the media, it's always, you know, people that have been actually picked up and put in body bags, and then it goes into an official count. You know, when you have a case where most people have been washed out to sea and stuff, I mean, you'll never get a number. You know, and if you don't capture the enormity of the impact on people's lives, then, yeah, I mean, they'll rebuild the island and it'll just continue as normal, right? But the reality is easy to find out in most of these cases, but people don't have the time to do it themselves. Like, they should say, okay, I mean, I can see them saying five people, you know, would, like, to say the death toll is at least five is completely negligent reporting, right? Five people. And they stuck with that for days and days. And I thought, I wonder when they're going to, and that was, in, and then they showed, but they showed all these images of complete destruction on the island. And then the next thing they said, well, the five people were killed.
What this is, Paul, this is public insanity. It's not personal, it's not hidden, it's just public insanity.
Yeah, it is. It is, and this is done all of the time, right? Like, an earthquake destroys a city, you know, you find 10 bodies on the outside and, you know, there's at least 10 people killed.
Yeah, well, you know, it's like saying, hey, Billy, I know your mom is gone, but she's gone to a better place, and I know she's happy where she is. And so it's like fairy tales that you tell to children.
It is. It really is fairy tales, and they get away with it, right?
Yep.
Like there's not pushback. And like, they could say, okay, we've recovered five bodies, but the whole city's gone. It looks like, you know, it's probably thousands and thousands of people. You know, or they could say that this city has, you know, this island of Abaco Island has 17,000 people documented. You know, we think that there's about 7,000 to 9,000 undocumented Haitians on the island. The island was completely covered with water, and, you know, we know of, you know, a few thousand getting off the island. So, you know, the death toll could be staggeringly high, like 10,000, 12,000, 15,000 people on the island, but here, we put five people in body bags, right? We've only identified five people, right? Like they just don't have any, they're completely out of touch with reality. And then they spread this around the world, and somebody reads about this big hurricane, and, oh, there's five casualties.
We're all totally out of touch with what is really happening in the world, and I think that's one of the stories of climate change. We can't believe it. We don't want to make any changes. I mean, after a lot of these things happen, after Great Britain declared a climate emergency and various countries declared climate emergencies, I thought, well, good. Now all my neighbors have stopped driving pointlessly and they've canceled their winter vacations to nowhere. But no, they haven't.
Yeah, no. I mean, that's just like empty words, the declaration of climate emergency.
Yeah.
right? the Canadian government did it. They debated it in Parliament. Didn't they declare it too?
Yes, I think so.
Many cities have, and Ireland has. There's other countries that have. So it's a crazy, crazy situation. But we keep going. We keep ticking, right?
Apparently.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, part of what you do actually, helps you deal emotionally with what's going on, right? Because you're doing your bit.
Oh, totally. I would go insane if I couldn't talk about what I see as possible reality with scientists, with people like yourself. Paul, for the opening of this season, I had some important science to cover, but then we had the heat waves in Europe and India, the fires in the Amazon and the Arctic. Then this unexpected destruction of the beautiful Bahamas. I feel like you and I are becoming ambulance chasers for climate disasters, this Dorian wrecking the Bahamas, it made me kind of angry and sad. I just had to walk away for a couple of days, but here we are. Does this drumbeat of climate disasters we all saw coming, does it ever get to you, Paul?
Oh, all the time, yeah. Yeah, it does. Yeah, I mean, it's very, very difficult to deal with it. And, the disruption of the jet streams and the, increase of extreme weather events around the world and the sea ice collapsing, although it was very interesting. I'll do some videos very soon about why the extent stalled, but the volumes tied for a record low, the volume of sea ice. So it's just the way the dynamics of the ice was working. It wasn't like the melt slowed down or anything. But yeah, I mean, there's just very, very difficult to deal with. And, it's quite possible that as things get worse and worse, around the planet, that there's fewer and fewer people that actually talk about what's happening. They want to maintain their sanity. They don't want to, go off and get completely stressed and anxiety and so on and not be able to function. Right. So, it's far easier for the human psyche just to, turn this stuff off. Right, even for people that, study it deeply.
Well, I'm asking people to turn it on with your YouTube videos at paulbeckwith.net and with my radio show at ecoshock.org. We have to wrap it up there. From Ottawa, we have been talking with Canadian climate scientist Paul Beckwith, and be sure and support his work at his website, paulbeckwith.net. Thank you again, Paul, and let's stay in touch as always.
Thanks a lot, Alex.
I'm Alex Smith for Radio EcoShock. Let me add one personal story, and it is something that makes me less suitable to host this show. When I was 15, I took a bus to Florida around spring break. With little money, I was looking for a way to get a dirt cheap hotel room and some food. It was actually cheaper to take a cruise ship to the Bahamas at their bottom rate than to stay in Fort Lauderdale, so I went. Since I had no jacket and tie for the dining room, ship management sent me to the back table, and that was where all the Bahamian staff ate. We became great friends. Landing at Nassau, a half dozen Bahamians loaded me in an old car heading into the back hills, and there I learned that white people are so uptight they barely know how to laugh and don't think it's right to laugh in public. We danced all night, me a skinny teen. Great music, the only white person around. The Bahamians were so deeply friendly, so kind to me, so able to laugh and enjoy life. Now, these thousands dead in the Bahamas, killed by a climate-enhanced Hurricane Dorian, they are real to me. I mourn the people and the life lost there. I touched this story and got hurt. I dedicate this program to the good people of the Bahamas. I will be back next week, and I hope you will be too. This is Alex Smith for Radio EcoShock. Thank you for listening and caring about our world.